This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Know-How is brought to you by CashFly.
This episode of Know-How is brought to you by Lynda.com, the online learning platform with over 3,000 on-demand video courses to help you strengthen your business, technology, and creative skills. For a free 10-day trial, visit lynda.com/know-how. That's lynda.com/know-how. And by Braintree. Even the best mobile app won't work without the right payments API. That's where the Braintree V.0 SDK comes in. One amazingly simple integration gives you every way to pay. Try out the sandbox and see for yourself at braintreepayments.com/know-how.
Today on Know How,
it's the Amazon Prime Air Reborn,
multiple monitor madness,
and a Christmas pie miracle. Ho, ho, ho. Know How, it's the Twitch show where we build, bend, break, and upgrade. I'm Father Robert Ballecer.
I'm Bryan Burnett.
And for the next however many minutes it takes, we're going to show you some of the projects that we've been geeking out to so that Alex doesn't show us how late we are.
It's going to be a lot of minutes.
It's going to be a lot of minutes.
Because as soon as I start coughing again, we're going to have to cut the show.
Bryan is a little bit sick. The hippo is more than just cranky. He picked up a flu, cold. What is it?
It's just a cold.
I want to thank you for bringing it in so that you could share it with everybody here.
Yeah, I made sure to not cover my mouth and walk up and down the alleyway.
I've seen you've been like licking mice and keyboards, so
yeah, but
it's good stuff.
You know where I learned it.
Remember me? Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, I like to share.
Well, yeah, you share too much.
Yeah.
TMI.
Speaking of sharing, we want to share some news about, a little something that's in our alley of expertise that's been making the rounds of the interwebs. Specifically, Amazon's drone fleet. Remember them?
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's where Amazon was going to bring packages to your house via drone. And I'm guessing, like, airdrop them into your backyard.
I kind of like the idea of them just, like, dropping it just from, like, from height.
With, like, a little parachute that pops
out?
No, just completely drop
it. Just go.
It's broken, but it got there. The fact that it fell from the sky was pretty cool.
We saw this not too long ago. It was actually, when did they first announce Amazon Prime Air? It was like at the beginning of the year. Well, actually, it was towards the end of last year.
It was probably, because everybody thought it was an April Fool's joke,
They thought, oh, this can't be right. This is ridiculous. Delivery with a drone? Mm-hmm. But they actually did come up with a proof of concept. It was their first version. And in the first version, what you saw was, okay, well, it looks like the Amazon interface. Mm-hmm. Once it's ordered, it goes to the warehouse, but now it goes into a little shipping container that gets locked onto by it's actually a smallish octocopter.
Right.
No, they were claiming that, they can get this thing out about 10 miles away from the warehouse, and it would go to your door via GPS coordinates, it would drop it down, and then take off. And it would send you a little chime on your phone saying, hey, the thing has arrived, and that was supposed to be Amazon Prime Air.
Right.
Now, interesting idea, but as you said, a lot of people thought it was an April Fool's joke.
Yeah, I mean, despite the hurdles with the, like, getting it to be legalized, there's so many other, you know, things that they had to figure out for that to even exist. But
it sounds
like it's going to happen.
It's technically feasible whether or not it's actually going to happen. We know that they have an exemption from the FAA, so they are doing tests. Mm-hmm. They've really developed the platform. It used to be just an octocopter, something that we could build. We didn't know much about the avionics. What kind of avoidance systems did it have?
Right.
Could it recover from a fault? Like, for example, if you have an octocopter, you have redundancy. So if you lose a motor or a prop, it won't drop out of the sky. But how much cargo can you carry before that's no longer possible? Because if you carry a certain amount of cargo, if you lose a motor, it now doesn't have enough lift.
Right, so then it's just going to drop your package to save itself. Yeah,
I like that. It's like, save yourself!
Yeah, drop the cargo!
But now we have version 2. And version 2 is an interesting bit of technology. So it's the same setup. You know, you order it, it goes to the warehouse, it gets put in a box. But now there's an internal bomb bay on the drone. And this, as you can tell, this is much different. It is it's an octocopter with inverted propellers. But you'll notice it does VTOL takeoff, so vertical takeoff and landing. But then it transitions to normal flight. Now, we've seen this before, but as you see, there's a propeller in the back. So unlike some other VTOL craft that pivot the motors or pivot the wings,
right,
this keeps the motor static, and it just has a dedicated motor that provides forward flight.
That is awesome. That probably helps a lot with range, though.
Oh, gosh, yes, because you can get so much more range out of a plane than you can out of a quadcopter, because a quadcopter is balancing on its lift, whereas a plane, you've actually got the wings that provide a lot of it, as long as you've got forward motion. So they're saying they can do 15-mile range on this thing. There's still no real idea of cargo. It can scan for a delivery zone. It's this little Amazon mat. It knows that's where you want to leave it. But it also shows a little hint of what the avoidance systems look like. It can actually detect objects in the air and fly around them or avoid areas altogether. A lot of people see this as, well, I guess they are serious. If they weren't, they wouldn't have really developed the technology. This does look like a giant step ahead.
Yeah, I'm dying. Sorry.
We've lost Cranky Hippo. I'm sorry. Yeah, Cranky Hippo. If we could get Amazon Prime Air to deliver, like, throat lozenges, that'd be fantastic.
It just started as I was watching the video. But the thing I could see happening is if the Amazon Prime Air was coming into my backyard like that, my dogs would freak out
right.
and go after it.
Right. Well, no. That's the thing. It is technically feasible, but there are so many unknowns.
Right.
I'm not saying that those unknowns mean it's not going to happen. It just means we have to figure out the unknowns before we actually do it.
Yeah, but it doesn't actually seem out of the realm of possibility now, especially with the VTOL setup. That's pretty cool. But now I'm also imagining, so you know how people go around and follow vans, like delivery vans,
then
steal packages off doorsteps? Like, what if there are pirate drones that just grab other drones out of the air or pick up packages and take them away?
That is a significant setup. I mean, you're looking at a drone that's going to cost several $1,000s by the time it's done. With the advanced avionics, with those motors, with those props, with that kind of bomb bay setup, it's an expensive craft.
Yeah.
So you have to wonder how many of these are you going to have in the air at any given time, and
what is
your acceptable loss, and what is your policy for when they do go down? Because eventually something will happen, something will glitch, and you'll have an Amazon Prime Air drone slamming into the side of a building.
Right, or going into somebody's pool, like they thought the pool was somewhere to drop off something.
I'm gonna put the Amazon plaque at the bottom of the pool. Gotcha.
No, I like this idea a lot. What I would like to see it be more than even just Amazon Prime is like deliver me a pizza or something.
Yeah,
so
50 minutes or less.
I don't want to leave my house.
Okay,
I don't want to get out of pajamas. Just drop off like a 6-pack and pizza on my doorstep.
Yeah. Well, folks, that is the last drone item that we're going to do for this episode. I know some people get tired of it, but this is interesting because we are seeing the transition of drones from fun things that we like to build, to there's actually a business model behind it.
And a huge economy, yeah.
They actually revised the estimate. They were saying that in 2015, drones were going to account for about $1 billion in sales. They're now saying that drones are going to account for about $3 billion in sales
in
just the United States alone. So this is big business.
Yeah, no, it's... I think the biggest limiting factor has always been the battery technology.
Right.
So as long as that...
Get that sorted.
If that keeps getting better and better, then, yeah, I'm excited to see that happen someday.
You know what else I'm excited about?
What's that?
Multiple monitors.
Yeah, you're going a little crazy with the monitors.
Yeah, you may notice, and Alex, actually, if you go ahead and switch to input 11, this is a setup that I had at Interop. These are just two Ergotron stands with 8 monitors. Now, those were 17 or 19, I think 17-inch monitors that I had set up in an Octo configuration off of one really powerful desktop. in that particular case, I had used a bunch of DisplayLink USB adapters, but I've also done this setup using specialized video cards that support massive clusters of displays. That got me thinking, multiple displays have sort of become the norm. We all have them. I mean,
yes.
We like having at least 2 monitors. I've got 4 at my desk here. I've got 6 at my desk back in my my studio. And I thought the folks out there might want to know how to set up a couple multiple monitors of their own. What do you think?
Definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, when I'm editing, I have to have 2 monitors now because I'm so used to it. But, I could go with a 3rd or a 4th, have some other stuff on there.
SCR1 is saying 8 monitors. I'll never have to leave the basement again. Actually, CR1, you will, because someone will have to pour out the jugs filled with...
Right, exactly.
If you could grab this. Okay, so this is what an Ergotron stand looks like. We've only got 2 on this because it's already really, really heavy. So this, if you did want to set up a massive multiple monitor setup, you'd probably use something like this. Now, there are different variants of this. Some of them attach to the desk. This one is just sort of it's on a big stand. It covers your face. I like that. That's good stuff.
This one's got a mustache.
This one has a mustache. Now, we like these because we can make sort of pods of monitors. We're able to sort of, make by function how we want to group it. And actually, this very stand, this was the stand that was used on Skypezilla all those years ago. Remember that?
You want me to take care of that?
Skypezaurus.
Whatever it was called.
This thing is kind of heavy.
Right?
It is. It's a little bit heavy. All right, I'm going to put this on the floor so that you can see us again. Now, Y Guy in the chat room is asking how much a stand like this costs. If you buy it used on eBay, you could probably get it for $200.
What is it brand new?
$300 to $400.
Oh, okay.
So they are a little bit pricey. But again, consider this. Do you really want to trust a cheapo stand with,
Definitely
$2,000 worth of monitors?
Well, those are solid. When we first did the first no hole down underneath where our feet are right now, I had two monitors down there, and you're like, no, Bryan, that's not enough. Two monitors is for amateurs. You need four monitors. And so you brought that out, and the next thing I knew, you had put all the monitors on that. And it held all four monitors. It widescreen monitors.
It's really,
as well.
Really sturdy. I actually have four of these at my house. I posted a picture on Twitter, and people were saying, that's not real. I'm like, dude, that's if I had more room in my studio,
you would do more.
That would be set up. That was set up in D.C. But all right. So we wanted to show you what you could do to get a multiple monitor set up. Maybe you're not going to be doing eight monitors, but maybe you want to do two off your laptop. Maybe you want to do three off your desktop, or maybe you want to start looking at four, five, six, eight, 12, 16. I don't know what you're going to do. But we want to show you how to do it. Now, we've got this little computer right here. I'm going to go and pull the HDMI. You're going to lose input 11, Alex. And so what we want to do is we want to show you some of the ways that you can use the technology that's already built into your devices to expand your monitor real estate. It's going to include the traditional ports on your laptop. It's going to include things like USB and Thunderbolt. And it's going to include things like wireless technology. These are all available to you right now. And if you want to be multiple monitor goodness in your studio, you can do that. If you want to do it on the go, you can do that. Mm-hmm. That's what the show's going to be all about.
Sweet.
Let's talk about the obvious. I'm going to assume, and maybe I shouldn't do this, but I'm going to assume that all of you know how to enable multiple monitors on your operating system of choice.
As operating systems have become more advanced, it's pretty easy now.
Oh, yeah. And so, for example, on Windows, Alex, you should be getting 11 back now. It should have reset. If you're using Windows XP and above, multiple monitors is already built in. That's baked into the operating system. You see it again? There we go. So, like, for example, if I do this, screen resolution, it's going to show you how many devices I have connected. Right now, I have two devices. I have one through the HDMI, and I have the internal monitor on the laptop itself. Right now, it's duplicating. So anything I see on one screen, it's going to be on the other. But if I do extend, you'll see that the icons change from, let me switch that back. It's going to switch from one display with two numbers on it. So it tells me that both of those monitors are seeing the same thing, to two monitors, each with their own number. And that tells me that I'm going to have two distinct displays. Mm-hmm. Now, this is for Windows. And this is Windows 8, but it works the same for Windows XP, Windows 7, Windows 10, and Mac OS 10 is the same way.
Right.
If you use an internal port, the computer will be aware that you've connected another adapter.
Right. I think the only difference is when you're on Mac, it says mirror. Like, you're mirroring your screen. Is it just a different way of saying?
Right. But you play around with the settings until you have it the way that you want it. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, Alex, if you go back to my screen, one of the things that a lot of people need to work on is how you position them. So if I were to, let's do this, where's my extend? If I were to do this, I now have the option of putting each display where I want it. So you can make the setup inside the virtual setup mirror what you see in the monitor setup, the real setup. Hold on, there we go.
Save it.
See, right now, I'm messed up because I've got this monitor on the wrong side, so I'm not really sure which way I want to move the mouse. But I could take this and I can switch it to either side and make the setup in this little box look as close to the setup in the real world as possible.
Right.
A practical note here, if you're going to be mixing and matching sizes and resolutions of monitors, which you probably will because most of us aren't buying three or four monitors of the same type at any given time.
I didn't know.
I didn't,
right? Because the way I did it is I had my old monitor from my old computer, yep. Got a new computer,
and then I just use them both.
Yeah, I didn't want to throw my old monitor away.
It will absolutely work. Both Windows and OS X will work with mismatched screens, but you should know that if the size and the resolution don't match up perfectly,
yeah.
You're going to have to play with that border control that I just showed you, where each monitor is, because the mouse movement across won't
yes.
be smooth. You'll find it like it pops up on the other screen.
Right.
You've seen that before, right?
I've seen that before. And wasn't there an episode where we talked about where the mouse would stop at the edge of the frame?
And right, you had that's to, like, the hard edge. You have
the
to push
hard edge.
Through. Yeah. So, I mean, again, there's all sorts of settings that you're going to find once you start doing multiple monitors. Let's say this.
Mm-hmm.
On most laptops, modern laptops, you're probably going to find HDMI and maybe mini DisplayPort.
Right, or Thunderbolt.
Or Thunderbolt if you're using an
a
Apple.
A crazy Mac guy.
Yeah, Mac guy, which also doubles as a DisplayPort. So a mini
right.
DisplayPort looks like the Thunderbolt port, so you can plug that into any modern Mac with a Thunderbolt port, and that will output DisplayPort.
Right.
You're not going to find a whole lot of DVI anymore. There are still a few. I've still seen laptops with VGA, but those are super, super rare.
Yeah, that's old time.
Yeah, those are typically like business projectors
with
people who think they're going to be going to a conference center that's going to still need VGA. And
I could see that happening.
Yeah, but I mean, they're very few and far in between. So most of you are going to be using HDMI, DisplayPort, and Thunderbolt. And the nice thing about those is those buses also pull over sound. Mm-hmm. So if one connection will give you video and audio versus DVI or VGA, which would only give you video, and then you'd need a separate connection for audio.
Right. Yeah. It was a pain.
You remember that, right? Having to hook up.
The little blue end of the cable for VGA.
That was always fun.
Yeah, that was a pain in the butt.
But we wanted to show you, okay, so that's all normal. If you really want us to show you how to do that, write us in the Google Plus group. I'm assuming most of you don't need that. But
no.
What you may need is a way to expand beyond just the bare ports you already have. A
mm-hmm.
lot of you have maxed out the ports on your video card. Like, for example, remember our favorite desktop, the Predator?
Right.
That computer only has room for one video card.
Right.
Now, it's a nice video card. It's a GTX 770, but it has two DVI, two HDMI, and one DisplayPort. But I can only do three at any given time. So I can do the DisplayPort plus DVI and VGA, DVI, DVI, or VGA, VGA. I can't run all five at the same time.
Right.
What if I wanted to run more monitors than that? There's actually a couple ways to do it.
Hmm.
One of the best is to go through the DisplayPort. It's an incredibly, incredibly flexible bus. Let me show you what
That's
this is.
That's cool.
So this is something I picked up on Amazon. I think we have a link for this, Alex. We'll make sure that this goes in the show notes. This is the SIIG. It's a DisplayPort adapter. It's a DisplayPort to two-port HDMI. This can take a single DisplayPort in, and it can output two HDMI monitors up to 1920 by 1200 per monitor. That gives you a maximum resolution of 3840 by 1200. Now, this is also good if you're going to be doing distance runs, because you can do 5 meters before you get into the box and then 15 meters after you get into the box. So if you're going to be doing one of these setups where your displays are far away from you,
right.
This is a nice way to make sure you don't exceed the cable limit.
What happens if you exceed the cable limit?
You're going to get, sometimes it would just flat out not work.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it will like mysteriously desync in the middle of a job and it'll come back. You'll know.
Right.
You'll know right away if the cables aren't happy.
Too long.
Yeah. But the nice thing about this is it just uses DisplayPort. So what we have here is we've got, I have to do a lot of adaption here because I need to go from mini DisplayPort that's on the laptop to regular uh-huh. DisplayPort that's on this box. So I'm going to go from here to here.
I heard you liked adapters.
I have adapters
for your adapters.
Exactly. Now, normally, if you were going to do this, you would just get a cable that did mini DisplayPort to DisplayPort.
Yeah.
But we had one, and I think Burke broke it.
Oh.
Maybe he did, but I'm just going to cool. All right, so.
If he hasn't yet, he probably will.
Yeah,
someday.
All right, here we go. So let's put this in here.
Okay.
And then, by the way, I could run three monitors, three off this. I can run the DisplayPort, the HDMI, and the internal monitor at the same time.
You're having the USB problem,
yeah.
Where it's like, the first time you put it in doesn't work, second time flip it over, and third time it does.
So what we have, if you go down to the close-up, Alex, we've got, two HDMI going out. So these are going to these two monitors in the back of the set. And then I've got one DisplayPort in. This is already powered up. It's a standard 5-volt power supply. And so we're going to take our DisplayPort, which has been converted from mini DisplayPort to standard DisplayPort. Plug it in here, and if you go to the wide shot, Alex, what you should start to see is, after a second, these are going to come up. So this is now a monitor. It's not two monitors.
It's a seam.
A monitor.
Well, there's a seam, but it's basically a virtual seamless monitor.
Exactly. And I don't think you. Yeah, I can't mirror it, so you're just going to have to look at. If you look at that. hang on, I know. Do this. Go overhead.
There
okay. If you'll notice, it sees it as one monitor, which is one of the advantages of using this adapter. It's not seeing two different monitors. It's seeing a single monitor that's really, really long.
Is that the resolution for it, too?
It's a 3840 by 1200.
Right? Okay, yeah.
Yeah. So what this has done is it's taken two signals, two HDMI signals, and it's allowed me to push out to both of them via one DisplayPort. Now, this is nice if you're out of ports.
Right.
And I can actually start to daisy chain these. I can actually split off the DisplayPort if I really wanted to, although it starts to get bad.
Oh.
You get past like four.
You start getting stuttering and stuff?
Because most of us, like, this is a an integrated video card. This is not going to look good if I split it off too many times.
Yeah, how powerful of a machine would you want if you're going to be doing more and more monitors? Because I know for me, I had to have like a pretty good graphics card to be able to do two or three monitors at full resolution and then play a game or something like that on top of it.
It depends. So this is an i7. This kind of tops out at two 4K monitors. So it's got an internal 2K panel.
Mm-hmm.
I can drive a 1080p screen, and then I can drive this, which is like 2.5K, and then maybe a 4K monitor.
Right.
Past that, I get screen tearing. It can't keep up. There's just not enough oomph in the integrated graphics chipset to keep it going. But if you've got like a gaming machine, no problem.
You should be okay. Yeah. All right. You're going to want some horsepower, though.
You are. I will say, if you look at this, Alex, I think we have the close-up shot. You'll notice that it's split down the middle. This is the disadvantage to using an adapter like this, which is if you had two independent monitors, you could tell Windows, okay, that's a monitor and that's a monitor. And then if I open up a window, it will snap to that window, right?
Oh, so if you open a window now, it's going to be the whole screen.
So if I take this and I move it over here, and I maximize. It's going to maximize across everything, which makes this, unless you've got those the completely bezel-less monitors, this makes it useless for gaming.
Yeah,
because who's going to game like that?
Nobody's going to want a line down the middle of their screen like that.
Right. That's also, but you know, if you're using this as just a secondary display and you don't mind having to resize manually,
then yeah, it's great.
Yeah, it's great. The other thing that you can do, some of these. We'll have, you can get like desktop managers that run on top of Windows and allows you to like subdivide your screen.
Oh, okay.
I don't like those just because I've always find them to be a bit flaky. They always seem to crash whenever I'm doing something graphics intensive.
Yeah.
Which is why I'm no longer using this in my setup. I decided to go from this to just a 4K monitor, a big 4K monitor.
What's that box that you kickstarted that splits multiple inputs into one big screen?
Right.
Screens?
Well, but that's different. That's like a switcher. So that's like a mini TriCaster in a box. But you could use that. I mean, you could use that to throw your displays where you want it.
Mm-hmm.
This is just a nice, inexpensive way for you to hook up multiple monitors.
Right.
Another note here is that if you're going to use this setup, you need two of the same monitors. Because there is no way to differentiate them, you can't tell them this one's 1080 and this one's 720 or whatever. It's always going to push out the same resolution. So if you try to connect two dissimilar monitors to this adapter,
no good.
Best case scenario, nothing lines up. Worst case scenario, it will just say, no, I can't do that.
Okay.
It will like go to the resolution of the lowest resolution monitor, which will make the higher resolution monitor look horrible.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when you're doing this, make sure to steal all your coworkers' monitors that are similar to the one that
Did
you want to do this with.
Yeah. He's looking around. He's like, why are there so many desks with missing monitors?
So weird. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry about that. Again, this is $66 on Amazon. It's worth a try. I mean, if you really want to play with multiple monitors, if you think maybe you might be more productive if you had more screen real estate, it's a good way to go.
Well, especially if you were in my situation where I got a new monitor, didn't want to get rid of my old monitor, but I like wanted to just have like a monitor dedicated to the chat room,
right?
Or have like Skype or something on that monitor.
Exactly.
So it's kind of nice to have not throw away your old monitor and then just reuse it for like extra information.
Exactly. Now I'm glad you brought that up because there is actually a less expensive easier way to set up what you're talking about. Just that monitor for stuff, right?
Yeah.
It's going to be up. You just want it on at all times. Mm-hmm. So you're going to put it on a throwaway monitor. Well, that's not what this is for. This DisplayPort adapter would be really poor for that because it only sees one monitor and you'd be constantly resizing.
Right.
There is a very nice way to hook up multiple monitors, actually I've done up to 16, to one computer without using any of the traditional ports whatsoever.
I feel like you're not going to tell me right
away.
No,
I'm not. That's called a tease.
Yeah, exactly.
Tease that. We make you want to come back.
I feel like you're going to have to give me some knowledge before we can get to that.
I am going to give you knowledge. And you know where the best place to get that knowledge is?
I'm going to say lynda.com.
You know, Bryan, it's like we're bros.
We finish each other's sandwiches.
Fury.
Okay. See, I tried that with my actual bro, and he didn't do that. Yeah.
Sorry, Greg. You've been replaced.
Boom.
Well, folks, we're not here to talk about sandwiches or the kung fu, the chosen one warrior. No.
Bitten by a cobra and struck by lightning.
At the same time. Mm-hmm. Instead, we're here to tell you about lynda.com. Lynda.com is the place to go on the internet if you want knowledge. Well, we are all about knowledge here on Know How. Now, let's say you've got a new hobby, photography. You want to learn how to do it the best way, learn about lenses, learn about the body. Well, they've got entire courses on photography. Let's say you want to sharpen your Excel skills because you want to look better on your resume. They've got courses for that too. Drone building? Sure. Programming? Yeah, they could do that. Or just simple things like how to do crisis management. Lynda.com is a one-stop shop for the people who want to get it done. Now, Lynda is for the problem solvers. It's for the curious. It's for the folks who want to improve themselves or have a reference for things that they already know but maybe need a refresher course on. If you are interested in photography, you can check out their Photoshop CC Essential Training and creating cards, calendars, and books with photos for OS X. They also have advanced courses on performance tuning your Canon digital SLR and Lightroom Insider Training. And series like Photo Tools Weekly, Burt Monroy's Pixel Playground, and The DIY Photographer, which teaches you low-cost tricks and techniques to improve your photos. With a lynda.com membership, you can watch and learn from top experts who are passionate about teaching. These are people who actually do this in the real world. They're not just collecting a paycheck to talk on camera. And speaking of camera, the lighting, the audio, everything is perfect. It's not like, you know, some of those YouTube videos. Although I love YouTube as a source of knowledge, sometimes you don't want to have to worry about a shaky camera or horrible audio. Lynda.com makes sure that everything looks just right so you can focus on the learning and not on the production values. You get to stream thousands of videos and learn on your own pace. You get to make a playlist and start and stop when you need to. All of that means that the courses fit you rather than the other way around. You can also browse course transcripts, which I love because it means that if you're trying to find the answer to a particular question, you don't have to sit through an entire video module. You just look at it in the transcript, find that specific spot, go there, get your reference information, and you're out. That's why lynda.com is my chosen resource for figuring out things about, Photoshop or Adobe Premiere Pro. You can also download tutorials and watch them on the go on your Android or iOS device. So if you're going to be going on a vacation and you can have some downtime, maybe on the plane, well, why not download a lesson and improve yourself while in the air? Finally, you can share all of these playlists with your friends. There's nothing like the social aspect of learning. If you can get your friends interested in the same hobbies that you have, it just makes it that much more enjoyable. Now, folks, we love lynda.com, and I know you will too. And right now, your lynda.com membership will give you unlimited access to training on hundreds of topics, all for one low flat rate. Whether you're looking to become an expert, you're passionate about a hobby, or you just want to learn something new, I want you to visit lynda.com/knowhow and sign up for your free 10-day trial. That's lynda.com, lynda.com/knowhow. And we thank lynda.com for their support of Know How. Hey, Bryan.
Yeah.
You know all that stuff I teased you about?
Yeah, can we finally get to it?
I think so.
Sweet. Okay. So what is this stuff?
These are docks. Not the thing with
boats. I recognize this little blue one again.
Yeah, it's a little VGA. Yeah, notice how on this one, no VGA.
It's been phased out.
These are some of my favorite docks for laptops, but the same technology can be used for desktops. This one is a StarTech USB 3.0. This is a universal laptop dock. It's for laptops that have USB 3.0. Mm-hmm. But of course, we didn't want to leave those folks who have Macs out in the cold. You don't want to have to have Thunderbolt to a USB dongle and then USB.
I've got 3.0 on this.
That's silly. That's why we have this. This is a Thunderbolt dock.
Nice.
Does essentially the same job, but of course it uses the Thunderbolt bus, which does 10 gigabits per second, rather than the USB 3.0 bus, which does 5 gigabits per second.
More gigabits, better. Got it.
I want the one with the bigger GBs.
Exactly, with the Wi-Fis.
With the Wi-Fis, and include the Wi-Fis. So here's the nice thing, Bryan. Mm-hmm. When I use a dock, especially on a laptop, it allows me to replace all the multiple connections that I might have on my laptop. So
right.
if I'm sitting down, what do I have plugged in here? I probably have my mouse and my keyboard. Maybe one of them is wireless. I don't know. I probably have an adapter for my Ethernet because I like wireless. I'm not a big
especially
fan
if you're going to be coming on the network over Skype.
Yes.
You better be wired in.
You better be. You also might have connectivity to speakers or a headset, a microphone, and then any other USB peripherals that you might have. Mm-hmm. Now, the big thing for me is because I love multiple monitors, that should be pretty obvious by now, I can have multiple monitors hooked up to the dock mm-hmm. and with one connection that all gets connected. So I don't have to connect them individually and have my laptop look like an octopus with cables right. hanging out of it. I've got a single connection, and I'm good.
That's awesome.
I'm good to go.
Yeah, it gets rid of the clutter.
It really does. So what I want to do is I want to show you each of these individually, the pros and the cons, which way you should go. Let's go ahead and start out with this one. This is the StarTech Universal Laptop Docking Station. The StarTech USB 3S Dock HD is a universal docking station designed for those with USB 3.0 equipped laptops. It requires an i3 CPU with 2 GB of memory or better and is compatible with Windows XP and above, as well as Mac OS 10.6 and up. Combining a DisplayLink 3900 video chipset with a Realtek 8211E Ethernet adapter and a VLI 810 USB interface, the dock gives you dual displays, gigabit Ethernet, full audio, and a powered USB 3.0 hub, all in a single package. On the back of the dock, you'll find connectors for DVI, HDMI, and VGA video, a single gigabit Ethernet port, 3.5mm jacks for speakers and microphone, and 2 USB 3.0 ports. On the right side of the unit, StarTech added a third USB 3.0 port, while the left side has a Kensington lock port, the USB uplink, and a jack for 5-volt power. You can use two of the video connectors at a time, either HDMI and DVI or HDMI and VGA, but not VGA and DVI, with a maximum resolution of 2048 by 1152 per screen. Using the dock is simple. Connect all the peripherals that you intend to use, power the dock, then connect the single USB 3.0 uplink into a USB 3.0 port on your notebook. You'll automatically get a display link pop-up that will install the drivers necessary to use the onboard video device. I was up and running in less than 90 seconds. Performance of the unit is impressive, thanks to the 5 gigabit per second transfer rate of the USB 3.0 bus. I was able to drive all three screens at 1080p resolution with no discernible lag, pixelization, or artifacting. I tried to stress the dock by pulling 3 HD streams from the network over the dock's gigabit Ethernet adapter while simultaneously displaying them on the monitors. But again, I had perfect display of all content, even as I ran them in the background while pulling data off a USB 3.0 hard drive. I did notice that by copying data from the USB hard drive to the network drive while simultaneously pulling 3 HD streams and pushing them out to the monitors, the CPU utilization would rise towards 90%. But that was just 3 points above where it would be using a separate USB Ethernet adapter and the onboard HDMI port to drive just 2 monitors. Now, the people watching the live stream, might have seemed a little wonky at the beginning, but right. we're just repetition's good.
Making sure you're on your toes.
Making sure you're paying attention.
I can't help but notice you have a very eclectic things that
I
you
do.
Watch.
I do.
There's motorcycle racing,
which
Pokemon.
You got me into. Pokemon. Oh, who doesn't like Pokemon?
Well, that's true.
SAO.
Are you a Squirtle, right. Charmander, or Bulbasaur guy?
Bulbasaur just because. What?
You would say that. You are such a grass Pokemon.
Star Trek. Can you, what? So, two of those are easy. So, we got Star Trek Deep Space Nine. Uh-huh. We've got,
Flash?
No, the Justice League War, Infinite Crisis.
Uh-huh.
And then I'm not sure what the middle one is. Oh, Pacific Rim. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, things have to blow up. This is a Jaeger. That's how that works.
This is an average night, though, for you, right?
This
you watch
pretty,
three
yeah.
things all
well,
at the same
I mean,
time.
Well, I mean, I got to multitask. Otherwise, I feel like I'm being lazy.
Exactly.
But what I like about the USB adapter is that this is really just what's called a display link. Not display port, but display link chipset. And I've been playing with these for close to 10 years now. Hmm. Here's a couple of the ones that I had before. These are USB 2, so these were limited to really 720p, maybe slightly higher, because there just wasn't enough bandwidth over the USB 2 bus to be able to get more.
I mean, right.
If you tried to push more pixels, you got a lot of jitter, and it just didn't look good.
Okay.
But these are incredibly useful if you want to expand your desktop. Again, if you have a screen that you just want to have up there so the chat room can be seen,
right,
or so that you can see the weather channel at all times, these are really nice for that because it doesn't use one of your standard display ports. It uses a USB port, which you can split off.
Yeah, more USB ports than I have, you know, display ports.
All right,
cool.
And the other thing that I really like about this is because it has so many different ports and because I can run two monitors off it, again, it really does give me that option to just do this, have that be the only thing that I'm connected to.
Nice.
Now, let me make a few notes here. There are some decent USB docks that use the Display Link chipset, and there are some really bad ones. My personal favorite right now are the StarTechs. I've not gone wrong with the StarTech. They've been really bulletproof. I've been using them for about 4 years now, and I trust the brand. And when I have had bad products, they've always replaced it really quickly.
How much is that one?
So this one is what? I think this is $107.
Okay.
But you're also going to find Kensington makes a good one. Anchor makes a really good one. That's $95.
Hmm.
But there are some that I would avoid like the plague. I've had both of these, Diamond or Asus. They both make Display Link docks that are horrible. They just, I mean, and their customer support is non-existent.
Okay, so don't waste your time with those.
Don't do that. Now, that's for USB folk, but what are we going to do for the Thunderbolt people?
You know, I feel like you have an option right here.
Yeah, we do have an option. Now, it's faster, it's a little smaller, it's a bit more expensive, but this is for you Mac aficionados, or for the rare PC with a Thunderbolt port, the StarTech ThunderDock.
The ThunderDock is about the size of a TV remote, at 7.4 inches by 4.9 inches by 2.8 inches wide and just over 14 ounces heavy. It comes with a power brick, power cables for every corner of the planet, Thunderbolt cable, and a detachable weighted base so it can operate with either a horizontal or vertical orientation. With the ThunderDock, one port enters, many ports leave. The rear of the device is decked out with two USB 3.0 ports, two Thunderbolt ports with mini DisplayPort compatibility, an HDMI jack, and gigabit Ethernet. The front of the ThunderDock adds a third USB 3.0 port and audio jack. Using the ThunderDock is simple. Powered up, connect one of the Thunderbolt ports to your properly equipped Mac or Windows PC, then connect USB, HDMI, Ethernet, audio, and additional Thunderbolt peripherals at will. The HDMI port supports a maximum resolution of 1920 by 1080, while the pass-through Thunderbolt/Mini DisplayPort can support monitors with resolutions of up to 2560 by 1440. Video quality was smooth with no jitter, skip frames, or system hiccups, even with motion-rich video and USB transfers happening simultaneously. Unlike some USB to display adapters, Thunderbolt-connected video displays, even those running through adapters, have no lag. Seeing the laptop screen alongside either the DisplayPort or HDMI-connected screen shows no discernible lag, even when the video adapter was taxed with multiple streams of HD video. One note of caution. If you're planning on using the Thunderbolt pass-through to connect a natively equipped Thunderbolt monitor, you can display both the Thunderbolt and HDMI outputs simultaneously. However, if you want to use the mini DisplayPort functionality, it's either or. Plugging in an HDMI-enabled display will disable the mini DisplayPort functionality. Beyond the video capabilities, the ThunderDock gives you full-spec 10 gigabit per second Thunderbolt connectivity, as well as 5 gigabit per second USB 3.0. The ThunderDock supports USB-attached SCSI protocol, or UASP, for faster transfers. When we tested transfer rates with Crystal Disk Mark on our Windows box, the scores from a USB 3.0 flash drive connected through the ThunderDock were almost identical to the scores of the same drive directly connected to our test system. Just for giggles, we plugged the same drive into a USB 2.0 port, and, well, let's just say that if you have a system with USB 2.0 and Thunderbolt, you definitely want a Thunderbolt to USB 3.0 adapter. The Gigabit Ethernet port worked as promised. There have been reports of glitches in getting both Windows and Mac computers to recognize the Ethernet port, but our test unit was up and running in seconds. In all, the StarTech ThunderDock is an excellent addition to the desk of anyone using a Thunderbolt-equipped notebook. It's fast, relatively low-priced, and nearly bulletproof.
I do like Thunderbolt because it doesn't use up CPU time like a USB dock does.
Right.
But I will say all Thunderbolt peripherals are crazy expensive. And this is no exception. So the USB dock is about $100. Mm-hmm. This goes about $160 to $200.
One question though, where did you get that Mac?
I found it really familiar. It was sitting back in the edit bay. It looked like it was abandoned, so I just thought I might use it for a test.
I don't remember ever letting you borrow my laptop.
Who says it was your laptop?
Maybe it wasn't. Totally. With the motorcycle videos on it. I wonder whose it was.
Because I don't have a PC that has a Thunderbolt port. I do, but it's my desktop, and I wasn't going to drag my desktop in just to do a review. Options. I do like this because it worked incredibly well. It was fast. It was easy to install. However, there are a few drawbacks that I did mention, and I think you should know this. If you're going to use it for a multiple monitor setup, I can do HDMI, I can do DisplayPort, but I cannot do them at the same time.
Yeah, that's kind of
that's a downer, right? Yeah. Now you can do, if you have a Thunderbolt monitor, you can do HDMI and a Thunderbolt monitor at the same time, but there's not many of us who have Thunderbolt monitors.
Yeah, no, I don't.
Yeah, because if you hook up the mini DisplayPort adapter in here, it actually kills everything else. It turns off the HDMI, and that's not unique to this. That is actually most Thunderbolt docks.
Okay.
If you throw something into the daisy chain, that's gonna end the daisy chain. It doesn't work anymore.
All right, good to know.
Yeah. When we come back, I'm gonna show you some portable options. Now, I'm sure your folks, you want to know what you can do when you're on the road and you want your multiple monitor madness, right?
Yes, well, definitely. We've
got some of those too. But before we do that, you know what I want to do, Bryan?
What's that?
I want to talk about one of the easiest ways to get mobile payments on your app.
How would you do that?
I would do that with Braintree. Braintree is a really easy way to integrate payments into your mobile service, your mobile app, whatever it may be. In the old days, if you wanted to do a payment service, you would have to make some sort of contract with a payments processing company. You'd have to make sure that your server is secure because you're managing it. And you'd also have to make sure that it's always updated because you really don't want to lose your customers' financial data. That's like the kiss of death, especially for a small business. But Braintree does that all for you. It takes away the voodoo from integrating payments and instead lets you put it into your app with 10 lines of code. Now, the Braintree V.0 SDK is one of the easiest ways that I know of to get secure tokenized payments. And tokenized means that your customer's information is never on a server somewhere that can be stolen. It's always unique. It's always protected. It's always secure. Now, developers, don't worry about it. They got you. I know that there's a lot of APIs out there that you don't like because they're not well documented or there's a little bit of voodoo that is involved in getting it to work right. Not only is everything documented with Braintree, but they'll actually have one of the representatives sit with you and babysit you through the integration if you're having trouble. Now, if you are wondering about their compatibility, well, they support Android, iOS, and JavaScript clients. They've got their SDK in 7 different languages, including .NET, Node.js, Java, Perl, PHP, Python, and Ruby. And, again, it's only 10 lines. 10 lines of in-app code. Now, one of my favorite features is that they've got a sandbox that allows you to test your integration with real-world traffic without actually risking the integration, risking your customers' data, or risking your internal database. Braintree knows that they are the public face of your company, and so they're not going to drop the ball. Now, here's what we want you to do. If you are making your own mobile app, we want you to try Braintree. Braintree gives you an easy way to accept multiple payment types with one integration by integrating it into your app with just 10 lines of code. No matter what you want your customers to pay in, Braintree's got a solution for you. Try out the sandbox now and see for yourself at braintreepayments.com/knowhow. That's braintreepayments.com/knowhow. And we thank Braintree for their support of Knowhow. Hey, Bryan.
Yes?
You know what I like when I'm on the road?
Steam buns?
Steam buns. I do like steam buns, but I also like having multiple monitors. This is sort of the new travel grumble, which is when I'm home, I've got big monitors, I've got multiple monitors.
Right.
But then when I go on the road, especially if I'm video editing and I go back down to one smallish screen,
it's a pain in the butt.
And what I've actually resorted to doing a lot of times is I will plug in my laptop to, normally it's an HDMI TV in the hotel room.
Right.
It's normally not a great TV.
So
it's
like a 720p or something. 720,
or like, or the, you know, the angle is just off because it's attached to the dresser. So I'm not working on the dresser.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a really good solution, but it's what I've got.
Right.
At least that's what I had until I found out that they were making portable USB monitors.
Nice.
Now, this is from AOC. This was one of the very first ones I had. In fact, when I first came on Twit, this was the one I was using.
How old is that now?
This is, what, 4 or 5 years old?
That
four?
Looks like one of the, like a picture frame, a digital picture frame thing.
And it's about as high quality.
Okay.
It was great for its time because what it could do is it had one connection, USB 2.0 connection. That's just a mini USB.
Wow. Okay.
And that would power it and provide the data. This was limited, just like those other display link adapters there.
Right.
This was limited to 720p,
okay.
Which was still nice.
Yeah.
But ultimately, what killed this for me is the quality of AOC is not great, and this died like 5 times. They replaced it 5 times, and then finally, I'm like, no.
Just don't bother.
Just don't bother.
At least they replaced it.
They did. They made a good effort. But, I mean, you're going to get what you pay for. This was a sub-$100 monitor. This was mm-hmm. like $79 when I bought it.
Now you've got a nicer one.
I've got a much nicer one. Same idea, but uh-huh. it updates. It still uses the DisplayLink chipset, but it goes from USB 2, which we know is limited,
right.
to USB 3. Now, USB 3 has that juicy 5 gigabit per second bus,
mm-hmm.
which means I can do full HD, 1920 by 1080. Looks
like a tablet.
This does. This is sexy. This is an Asus, and I got to say, this is probably the best mobile monitor on the market. It's an MB 168 Plus. It's a 15.6-inch USB monitor, about $280. So it is a little bit pricey,
mm-hmm.
but it does 1920 by 1080. It has 11 millisecond response time, has a 600:1 contrast ratio. It only weighs 1.7 pounds, so it's you know, a little bit lighter than my laptop, but altogether it means I can travel with a dual monitor setup under 4 pounds, actually closer, about 3.5 pounds.
Yeah, it looks really nice.
So it's got a single connection here for USB 3,
mm-hmm.
and it's going to go ahead and power up. See, it's Asus, it's coming in.
Comes with a pencil?
No, this one doesn't come with a pencil. But what this does is, see, as you can see, it's now extending the desktop on my laptop over here, which is nice.
That's pretty nifty.
I can move this over. Hey, look at that. Hi, here's my show notes for know-how. Hey. The other nice thing I like about this is the carrying case is also a stand, which you're going to need because it doesn't have a kickstand like that AOC.
Wow, okay.
Yeah, so you have to do this. It's a little janky because you only get one position.
Huh, I'd almost wish it had a kickstand or something like the Surface.
Right,
know?
Yeah, but the issue with that is the kickstand's going to make it thicker. It's going to make it
true.
Heavier. I'm okay with this. I'm actually going to 3D print a kickstand for this.
Oh, good idea, yeah. A little slot that it kind of fits into.
We've got Dr. Morbius asking for the FPS. This actually will do I think it's a 60 hertz refresh rate, but I mean, it's an LCD. Mm-hmm. I have done gaming on this. One of the things to remember about the DisplayLink adapters is that doesn't do the graphics processing. The computer does the graphics processing, and then it sends it over the bus to the display link. So as fast as the video card is in your computer, that's the video you're going to get on the display link adapter.
Yeah, and this is 1080, so it's pretty sharp.
Yeah, I mean, I watch movies on this. But for me, the big thing is whenever I'm doing editing on the road, it now means I have a screen that's about the same size as the screen on my laptop that I can do side by side, and I can have my multiple monitor setup on the road.
Yeah, no, that helps a lot, and the fact that it is so small and light is very handy for traveling.
Right.
Can I have it now?
No. I mean, I did have to buy this. I had to save up a long time because I've been wanting a nice USB monitor, and I've been so tempted to buy one of these because there are USB 3 monitors for like $120.
Yeah.
But I'm looking at them, and all the ratings are, oh, this is horrible. I wanted one that was actually going to last, that was going to work.
Right. Well, you already tried the AOC, so these seem to be on opposite sides of the spectrum.
They do. And again, I'm not disparaging AOC. For the price, it's really good. It's just, this is one of those times where you're going to get what you pay for.
Well, yeah, I could see this is the one that you will get if you are somebody like you on the road who needs to video edit something. AOC might be the one that you give a chance if you're just plugging in to have like video play on a second monitor.
Exactly, exactly. All right, you want one more?
Yes.
Let's do one more. So we've shown you a lot of different monitors, a lot of different monitor technologies, ways to hook up via USB and Thunderbolt. That's all good. Mm-hmm. I mean, and hopefully you'll be able to take that to heart. There is one more thing I want to show you, and that is, what if you wanted to connect wirelessly?
Yeah, that would be nice.
Surely not, Bryan. What is this
what are you, crazy?
Wireless you speak of? That's crazy talk, right? No, actually, you can do it, and you're going to do it with this. This is a very low-cost adapter. I'm going to put it on the overhead so you can... There we go.
Microsoft.
This is a Microsoft WiDi adapter. It's a wireless adapter. Mm-hmm. The nice thing about one of these things is they are cheap. Right now, if you were to get a Christmas sale, it's about $30, and the high point is about $45.
Okay.
So this is a very inexpensive monitor. It's about the same price as, say, an Amazon Fire Stick, but it doesn't include any of that extra functionality. There is no Netflix on this. There's no Hulu. It's not integrated. It does one thing and one thing alone, mm-hmm. and that is it receives a signal from any device that can use WiDi. Now, WiDi was created by Intel, mm-hmm. which, a few years back. It does 1080p. It does 5.1 surround. And it's not completely lag-free, but it's incredibly low lag.
Okay.
I probably wouldn't want to use it for Twitch gaming, but right. I could use it for casual gaming.
Or a movie or something like
no
that?
No problem.
TV?
It's cool. Solid. You can get about specs like 30 feet. I can get about 20 feet away.
Okay.
Because there is a lot of interference. It uses the same wireless device in your laptop that all of you already have.
So this is around 2.4 gigahertz?
Not necessarily. But this particular one is 2.4. But the nice thing is it doesn't disconnect the wireless. So if you're hooked up to a wireless AP, you don't have to drop that in order to access this, because otherwise it would be pretty useless, right?
How are you going to
stream Netflix if you can't actually connect to the Wi-Fi?
So how does it do that then?
That's what WiDi does. So here's how it works. So I'm going to plug it into this monitor here that we had for our multiple monitor setup. And I've got an external battery here, but this was designed to be used on those monitors that we have now that have USB ports.
Right, so it could be powered on that.
Right, so it would be powered by the USB. This is going to go ahead and power up. It's got a little bit of a boot up time. Mm-hmm. What it's going to do now is it's going to start as soon as it finishes booting up. I have configured it with a Windows 8 laptop. This will work, by the way, on Windows 7 and up, so 7, 8, and 10.
What about my XP machine?
No,
I wouldn't try that.
I mean, you could get a Miracast application and try.
Nah.
But yeah, I wouldn't do that. It'll also work on Android. I've done Miracast to this. I haven't done it with iOS yet, but supposedly it could work.
Okay.
Yeah. And so once it's ready to connect, what I can do is I can project this. And unfortunately, I can't hook up the HDMI at the same time. Otherwise, it will kill itself.
That makes sense.
But if you go to the overhead, let's do the overhead like that, you'll see now that it's detected it will say add a wireless display. I'm like, oh, and it actually, since I've already connected this, it has wireless Padre.
Nice.
I just click that. Go back to the wide so they can see it as I click it. I just click that. It will start connecting. This says it's connecting to Padre SJ. And in just a second, it's got to negotiate all the signal
strength.
Handshake, so on and so forth. And boop, I guess I get the blink on mine. It now detects it as a second screen. There we go. The cool thing about this is it is set up to mirror right now. But just like I showed in the first segment, if I open this up, this is that same window. So I can choose a mirroring. I can choose extending. If I was going to use the hotel wireless, the hotel TV screen, I now have a way to do it without stretching an HDMI cable between my laptop and my TV.
That's cool.
Now, as you can see, this thing is completely wireless. It's not connected to this at all. And let me go ahead and open up a video. I must have some video here. Yeah, that's one of my favorite groups of folks, the flight test folks. I mean, see, that's solid.
That's cool. Nice.
Right? Exactly. And now the nice thing about that is it also transmits audio. This would be perfect for someone who says you have got a big screen at the foot of your bed.
Mm-hmm.
You can now broadcast from your laptop wireless directly to this. Now, this is different from, say, an Apple TV or a Chromecast or even a Fire Stick, because those go through the network. So you are connected to the network. Those devices are connected to the network.
Right.
And then you go through the network to get to that device.
Right.
This is direct. So this is talking to this.
See, this seems like a great solution if you're going to a hotel or something like that. Because there's no way you could take a Chromecast unless you had your own wireless access point
Precisely.
That you brought with you. So.
Precisely. A temporary network. Or this is a great gift for someone who is not tech savvy. And they're like, I'm not connecting to the right AP. There's interference. No. All they know is there's an icon on the devices that says TV. and they hit the TV, and suddenly they're broadcasting to the TV.
Yeah, that makes sense. You plug it into the TV, the device that you want to see the screen on, and you go on your computer, and there you go, Grandma. You can watch your soaps on the TV.
Exactly. And it's funny, because I brought this to my family home in Las Vegas for Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
And I had it plugged in just because I wanted to show pictures, and my dad comes up to me, he goes, can you just leave that? And I'm like, if I wasn't going to use it for know-how, I'd give it to him, but I ordered another one for him, because he goes, I could play poker in the bed without a cable on the big screen. Like, whatever you want, Dad.
Whatever great. Makes you happy. It's a Christmas present now.
It's a Christmas miracle. Okay.
Nice.
But that's the Microsoft Wi-Fi adapter. Again, we will make sure that the links are in the show notes.
Cool.
Now, Bryan, we're running really late. So
yeah,
we got to wrap it up. But before we wrap up, I just want a quick parting shot. A shout out to a member of our know-it-alls, Chris Cabo. Thomas Nelson. He goes by Cabo Zone. He's our chopper right now. If you could bring up the link, Alex, this is something we talked about. He took a Raspberry, connected it to a set of relays. Go ahead and blow those up. There's three pictures.
Ooh.
And he's going to be running Christmas lights through this thing. Exactly. What I love about this is, you know, he's using a lot of the knowledge that we've already talked about on know-how. He obviously has a lot of know-how on his own. But these relays allow him to control high voltage, high amperage circuits without blowing up his Raspberry Pi.
Smart.
Cobblezone has promised me a video, so at some point he's going to show us what he's done.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to do one for the end of the year episode, but we got full up, so we're going to have to save that for next year.
We'll do it at the beginning of next year, so that you can prepare for the following holiday.
Absolutely. Okay, folks, I'm sorry, but that's all the time we have for this episode of Know How. I want to thank you so much for joining us. It's always fun to have you here. Hopefully you'll take home this knowledge and geek out on your own. Now, if they want to find out the links, because we had a lot of products in here, where do they go, Bryan?
twit.tv/KH. We'll have a list of all the products that we talked about today. And you can go there and find links also to download the episode or subscribe.
Yeah, and don't forget that you can find us on the Google Plus. Just go to Google Plus, look for Know How. It is a great group. We're getting like 9,400 or 9,500 members now. It's an incredibly active group. It's a great place to go if you want to ask a question.
Share
your projects, which will end up on the show.
So we've got drone crashing videos.
Lots of those.
Hopefully a Christmas light video, please. Community.
Yeah. So if you want to see what your fellow makers, doers, and DIYers are up to, go to Google Plus and look for Know How. And that's not the only social place they can find us.
No, if you want a behind-the-scenes look at the crazy things that we do when we're not doing Know How, you want to go to Twitter. And
Twitters.
I am at @cranky_hippo.
And I am at @PadreSJ. And our director, Hal.
Halex.
Mm-hmm. Uncle.
The Uncle. Guy who keeps getting angry at us and showing us the clock.
Yeah. That guy you can
Sorry,
find.
Sorry, we don't have time for this.
At A-N-E-L-F.
Nope, no time.
No time. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballecer.
And I'm Bryan Burnett.
And now that you know how.
Go do it. Go monitor it.
Go be sick.
Go cough off camera.